Christmas.
Take these pants off.
Ow!
All right, so tonight is a night to celebrate people, but especially women who have gone on adventures with their bikes. I'm really humbled and happy to introduce our panel tonight. We have four amazing women who have helped me above and beyond back when I was absolutely clueless. The first person I'd like to present is Liz Browne. We've got Crystal Talbot. And Jen Abercrombie. We all have stories to share. Where to start? Who would like to begin with their tale from the road?
Maybe you.
Me? Yeah. Oh, okay.
I guess so.
All right. So like I said, I am beyond humbled to be surrounded by these women who know so much more than I do about what it takes to leave and be self-supported on the road. And Prior to the trip that I took this past summer, I last minute decided to leave on that bike. Well, eventually it was that bike, but I left on a carbon road racing bike with those bags attached to it to attempt to ride from New York back home to LA self-supported. And I did it. Learned a lot about myself. But these women and a lot of the people in the community were the people that helped me figure out what I needed to do something like this. So thank you guys. And I thought, you know, what better way to go to this trip than to pick an excerpt from my diary, which I kept, and read it to you guys. So I'm gonna go get my diary that's in that bike over there.
I really wish this fire was a real fire right now. Sitting here with my puppy jacket. Like.
This was written on June 27th, 2016. Today was the most beautiful day of my entire life. Guys, I might get emotional. I'm just gonna say that.
Your entire life.
Guys. Let me preface this with, bikes have primarily just been like racing devices to me for the last 5 years. And in the middle of my racing season last year, I'd kind of had it with training and all of the stuff that you have to do, live like a monk, never see your friends, just so I can get 40th at Redlands, guys. 40th is the best I could do. So that's when I decided I'd heard about this trip, and I heard about it a week before it left, and I went in, I quit my job, and I quit bike racing, and I went and did this, and I just want to encourage anybody to do anything that scares the shit out of you. Okay? Because it'll be incredible. Anyway, along with the diary, I just did that so that I wouldn't start crying because I was about to, so I had to like segue. Today was the most beautiful day of my entire life. We rode over the Bighorn Mountains on fully loaded bikes. It was a 6,500 feet elevation climb, 30 miles. So I was comparing it to climbing Mount Wilson fully loaded, and I would never do that. Well, shit, it was incredible. I ran out of water at about 5 miles from the summit, and then I saw a man with a mountain bike with sprigs of lavender in his helmet on the side of the road. He filled up my bottles and sent me on my way. For some reason, about 15 minutes after that, something came over me. It was the culmination of everything that had brought me to this exact place at this exact time. The past, the strenuous effort I had put into the dream of pro bike racing, the relationships that have come and gone, the self-realization and finally witnessing just how much mental and physical strength I have, and what it has taken to make it this far on my bike all the way from New York. It also could have been that, don't judge me on this, Grimes Oblivion came on exactly at that moment. This is the song that I listened to in the elevator right after I got my first adult job at Warner Brothers 5 years ago when I was just a little squirt. But something happened. I started crying. I burst into tears of 100% joy, and I didn't stop. I was still wiping the undried remnants as I hit the top of the climb. Today was unbelievable. We ended our ride at the 10 Sleep Brewery. We had 7 pizzas, 16 beers between the 4 of us. I'm in my tent now, camping in the grass, surrounded by the red rocks at the brewery. Life is beautiful.
So.
Sounds cliche, but life on the road will actually change you. That's my share.
Well, my name is Jen Abercrombie, and I met all these ladies from riding bikes, and I would say that that's my favorite thing that bikes has brought to me, is all the people that I have met. And I'll say that maybe when Jen took on that tour from New York to LA, she was the least experienced of all of us, but she has like far surpassed me, certainly, maybe like 3 days into it. So I guess for me, coming here and talking to you guys about bikepacking and adventure and all that is like, when I was first riding bikes, I was just riding my bikes with friends on the road. I didn't know what I was doing. I ended up borrowing some bags and putting them on a bike that wasn't really the right, not exactly the ideal bike, and I borrowed some bags from Liz, and that's an important thing too, is like, ask all your friends. You don't have to like purchase a ton of equipment. You can borrow it from people, and you can maybe buy some stuff you need, but ask around, and don't be afraid to ask your friends, or not only about just all their tips and tricks, and then also I got a lot of help from my local bike shop, so you can, they can kind of help you, and I mean, I think you would agree, right? Like, you can, yeah, they can, like, help you figure out, you know, like, how to just get you on the road. You don't have to have, like, the perfect setup, but you can just get yourself out there and get going. And so it's a relatively short trip. You know, we just camped for one night. It was hot as hell, which ended up being good because we didn't have to bring tents. We just slept on the ground, like on a sheet, like a ground sheet. So I brought a sleeping bag. And like I would say it's good to just get started small. And then from there, we did some other stuff where, you know, you can, like, have your friends who don't ride bikes get involved and have them drive some of your stuff. You don't, like, what you did, totally self-supported, that's cool, but if you just want to have an adventure and not, and the, like, yeah, and the packing all the stuff is too, like, intimidating, like, kind of camp in tandem with your friends who can, like, car camp and you can ride and meet them and then they have your camping gear and you can do it like that. And then I did a one trip that was truly a bikepacking trip, like what I think of as bikepacking, where it's like backpacking, but you're on a bike. So you're off-road, you're carrying all your stuff. And that was like, I would say, that was something where I was kind of in over my head, but I was with people that I trusted. So if you've got friends who are willing to take you out somewhere where you're gonna be kind of out of your comfort zone, but you have people who know what they're doing, like, you could do that. But that's sort of like a comedy of errors in a lot of ways. Like, fire ants got into all of our food, and we ended up, like, losing, like, a bunch of the food, and things were kind of, it was a bit of a, well, okay, it was like some people came and they were gonna leave like a cache of food for us to find. Like, some people had come out before. And we got there in the pitch dark, couldn't find the food. Basically, we had like no food and fire ants had attacked the food that we did have. And so we were like out in the middle of nowhere with like nothing. And then the next day I was like, oh my God, I'm gonna die. Like, we had to like climb out of this canyon. So you're like descending in the dark at night, and that's fine. And then the next day you're like, oh God, how am I gonna get out of here? But that's what I'm saying, like, ride with people you trust, people that aren't gonna, like, you know, no one's gonna leave you behind to die in a canyon, even though you feel that way sometimes. So that's what you learn. That's what you learn, like, adventuring, you know? It's like, you get to know your limits, you get to know how much you can push past what you think are your limits, and you get to know all these people that, like, take care of you and ride with you when you're like freaking out and at your limit. And so that's what I have to say about adventuring, is like, there are times to do something small and make it like comfortable, manageable, and fun, and then there are times to just
see how hard you can go and see how far you can take it.
So to kind of talk about that point you had about getting help from your local bike shop, this is how clueless I was, guys. I asked Liz's boyfriend, Kyle, who owns Golden Saddle Cyclery, I said, what should I bring, a tent? I don't know, and he's like, yeah, you could do a tent or you could do like a booby sack. But I'd never heard that word in my entire life. So I was like, what's a booby sack? And then I called it booby sack, and everyone let me call it booby sack for a long time, for way too long. It's a booby sack. And it's like a claustrophobic like cover just for your body, smaller than that little tent I had earlier. All right, well, moving on.
Hi, everyone. My name's Crystal, and my story started out a lot similar to Jen's, where I was racing, and that's pretty much all my riding was geared towards doing, and I randomly got the opportunity to ride across the country. I had 9 days' notice, and I happened to be moving out of my apartment at the same time, so a friend let me store all of my stuff in their garage, and I got on an airplane with my carbon road bike with gold schmal wheels and like this totally ridiculous bike with a carbon saddle with no padding and got on a plane to New York and met up with a handful of other people where we ended up riding from New York to LA through the southern route. And I had no clue what kind of equipment to bring. I basically like ran out to REI the day before I left and like bought the things that I like had read about online that I might need. And the difference between my trip and Jen's trip is that we had a little bit of support. We had a vehicle that could carry our camping stuff from spot to spot with us, but our rides themselves weren't supported, so we were doing about 100 miles a day through the desert in the middle of summer and didn't have water stops sometimes. So so I basically like Googled for like the least expensive, largest rear bag that I could find and had it delivered to the hotel in New York and threw it on the back of my bike and stuffed it with peanut butter and jelly sandwiches and as much water as I could carry. And there's actually a photo of it up on the board. It's totally when I got back to, when I got back to LA, I had decided that racing was no longer for me, and riding my bike for fun or for exploring or adventure, being able to spend time with my friends was really what I wanted to do. So since then, I've done a handful of different types of bikepacking and exploring, and I want to talk a little bit about the equipment that that I've used. So, thank you. Hello, is this better?
Sorry, this is a karaoke machine. It's not really like, intended for this use, so.
So the type of riding that I've fallen in love with since then has been more of the brevet type riding, where we've done it in a few different ways, where we've enlisted a friend to carry some of our stuff to a camping spot halfway in between, halfway between our long-term goal, where we're gonna camp, and it allows us to go further than we usually would on a bike ride, and that's a really fun way to do it. I've done rear panniers that are fully loaded and decided that that's totally not for me. So one piece of equipment that I really like is are these rear bags like what Jen has and this. And between this and a front pack, you can basically carry everything you need for an overnight trip. With that, I can pretty much get away with everything I need if I'm going to stay in a hotel or something like that for a night. And it's cool. It allows you to go on rides that push you further and in new areas that you wouldn't be able to do on a normal road ride. And another thing that I've done a little bit of, but with rear panniers is fully loaded touring, and I never want to have to ride with panniers again. So I, for fun, what?
Why?
I don't like how it makes my bike handle. I feel like I don't like all of that weight on the rear. It just doesn't feel right to me. So being able to balance the weight over the front and the back and more kind of center your gravity a little bit feels more comfortable. So I, because of tonight, took out or decided that I was going to make my own frame bag for my mountain bike. And I wanted to see how inexpensive I could do it and if I could do it, because I really don't have very many sewing skills. So I watched a bunch of YouTube videos, and if anybody
has... I don't have sewing skills.
I don't.
You get that off the rack?
I've never made anything that's 3D. I've like made quilts, so
like
but that's it.
There's like an extra pocket.
So I watched a ton of YouTube videos, and then I went to Joann's, and I got fabric out of, they have like a 50% off. Been a fabric that's like pre-cut, and so I found something that seemed like it would be durable enough. It's not going to be waterproof, but I did that, and I got a $2 zipper and spent a couple dollars on Velcro. I think I spent like $20 altogether to make this, and it was actually really easy and really great. And now I'm going to use it to try to do some more fully loaded mountain bike packing, but I didn't have to spend like a couple $100 on a bag that I don't know if I'm going to use again. Another reason why I made my own bag is because my mountain bike is ridiculously tiny, and nobody makes a frame bag that would fit inside my mountain bike. So, unless it was custom, so it was a little bit out of necessity, and I kind of wanted the challenge. But you don't have to spend a ton of money to get into it. You don't have to be very experienced. I mean, we have friends who go bikepacking by using just the front baskets on their bikes and stuffing them up as high as they can. And you have fun. You don't need all fancy stuff, but except for when you're riding across the country every day, self-supported.
Yeah,
then it's really nice.
It was really hard to spend all that money, though.
Yeah.
And I have a hard time spending $50 on shoes or whatever.
I mean, and for most of us, like, we're going on weekend adventures. We're not spending, like, my cross-country trip was 55 days long. And so we went along the whole East Coast and then kind of zigzagged across the South. And it was... when you're doing something like that, having the right stuff is the difference between coming out of it without an injury or not. It took me like a few weeks to end up changing stuff out on my bike and a few injuries, like carpal tunnel so bad that I couldn't shift and my back going numb.
You figure it out. You do it. It's fun.
Yeah. Hello, everybody. I'm Liz Brown.
It's really jiggly.
Okay. I had one story to kind of tell, and I kind of realized after listening to everybody, like,
it's a series of stories.
So I kind of want to talk about my two experiences, and one I was very young and fun and reckless, and then the other time when I was like
more adult, working on
9-to-5. I decided to go up to Santa Cruz to visit a friend, and we got deep into some whiskey, and what just happens. And we were looking at plane tickets to Europe, and it came across a flight for, I don't know, $300, I think. And at the time, I was just graduating college. She was maybe going to get her PhD. I thought maybe this would be our time to, like, I don't know, meet some people in Europe. And so we, you know, we're girls, so fun. Anyway, so we buy these tickets, no plan at all. Like none, no plan. Honestly, we're gonna bring our bikes, and that's our only plan. At the time, they hadn't come out with the European bike map, at least for the part through Italy and some parts of Germany. They had kind of done the above part, like Amsterdam. So in Google, kind of, we had like an iPhone, yeah, and we could like look up the map on that, but didn't have great service. So we get to Switzerland, all things are good, you know, we're like feeling finally like we're out of the mess. Italy's very hard to ride on the street. And we start our way into Germany, and we hit the part of Germany, I don't know if you're familiar with Germany, there's the Rhine, which is this beautiful, long, pedestrian cycling dirt pathway along the river, and it's gorgeous. And there's thick with woods, kind of like this bird noise here. And, you know, where it's like people are stopping us, they're like, oh my God, like, where are you guys going? Like, help you. And I'm like, oh my God, that's amazing, I love you too. And I get to some part, and I realize that maybe I've left something behind, but not in the way that like my bike feels that light, like maybe a small piece of thing that I really need, and I stop. And we had been riding for 40, 30 miles or so, and I realized I left my passport back in Switzerland. And we never want to go back to Switzerland, it's very expensive, extremely expensive. And my sandwich was like $50, it felt like. So at this point, we're kind of in the middle of Germany somewhere. Not a lot of resources, and we pull off the Rhine, we find a small town, and we think, well, I look at my friend, and being the non-religious people we are, we think we go to a church because they'll help us. There's no one there. But we wait around because what we don't know is it's like breakfast and everyone like is taking a break. So we wait, people show up, and we finally meet this older couple, and they're just doing some office work at the church. They speak no English, not like one word, other than what I can understand is Autobahn. And so we get into the church, and we're trying to communicate with them for an hour. And finally another guy shows up. I think he was like another friend of family or something. And he has this idea and he's talking to them and he calls his son who speaks English.
And I'm like,
oh my God, thank you. Like they won't let us use our phone or internet or anything. We can't touch anything. And we're in Switzerland. We pop in. I go to the hostel where I left my passport, if you're wondering where I left my passport. And we zoom back. They send us off with bread, lots of bread, tons of bread. And I don't know if in that moment that I understood what had happened, right? And then we took off and we kept riding. I wanna fast forward really quickly, I have like 5 minutes, so I'm gonna go to another story. the other story is actually part of this. And I am with my partner, we're in Utah, and we're in Canyonlands, and we've decided, that's the reason we're there, is that we're gonna do Island in the Sky. This is my first bike packing trip on a fully loaded mountain bike. What does that mean to me at that time? I have no idea. I know my mountain bike, but I've never packed anything like that onto my bike before. Panniers have been what I've known. And I kind of have this, I'm a project manager by profession, so I'm type A, if you can't tell already, and I organize everything, and I schedule everything, and all the food's weighed out, and all that stuff, and so I'm like, got this, I've done the John Muir Trail, I've like backpacked, I know schedules, I could put an Excel sheet together, which I did, and so I kind of have this attitude, and I look at Kyle, and like, smile, like, yeah, I got this, fake it till you make it, right, duh, and we get our bikes packed up, and I'm like, okay, you know, doesn't seem that hard. We get going, our first day, and if I don't know if you know anything about Island in the Sky, it's a 100-mile off-road, primitive road in Canyonlands, and once you drop into Island in the Sky, you're in Island in the Sky, you overlook the Green River, and it's beautiful, and I highly suggest everyone does it. And what you experience is some mountain bikers doing some like in and outs, and then some guys on, you know, the discoveries and Range Rovers. It's really cool. We get going, and time is slipping really quickly. Sand is up to 6 inches. We're losing our patience, and we're supposed to be at camp, and it's getting dark. And so we finally drop near the Green River, and it's getting cold, and I can kind of feel
that we're getting close, but frustration's building. And we roll up to our camp finally. And instead of seeing an empty camp waiting for us, there's three guys and there's three like Discovery Range Rovers. And I look at Kyle and he just has this look of, what, you know, where are we? And I pull out my paper, my permit to look at the date, and I can't read anything, I can't comprehend what, you know, day has been so long. And we walk over to them and you can tell that they're like, what are you doing here? And I'm like, what are you doing here? And they're drinking their beers and they're kind of like in this moment of awe for the day that they had. And so we go up and we ask them like, hey, can I look at your permits? Like, I think maybe you guys aren't supposed to be here. In my head, I'm thinking this, you know, like, no, I've obviously got this right and planned. We compare permits and I'm upset. I fucked it up. We've arrived a day early and our campsite was for the next night. And I look at Kyle and he just smiles at me. I smile at him and I'm like, well, we're just gonna make this work. And we end up talking to them. One of them got like huge pin flat on one of the steep roads and hit a rock and plugged it, and we were talking about that. And one of the guys goes, wait, I saw you guys at the beginning of the day. And I was like, oh, really? Oh, cool. He's like, and you guys are here now? And I was like, yeah, we're here now. They hand us beers, and they're like, oh, well, like, of course you can camp here, like, over in the bushes, like, wherever you guys need to set up. And I think at that moment, I realized what it took for me to kind of realize what you're doing at any capacity, if it's something short, a day, a month, a week, was only shown to me by a stranger, which was really interesting. And that day back in Germany was this moment of that too, which culminated in Canyonlands. Was you can plan everything and you can have it all set up and it could be perfect, but it's almost a stranger that brings you to this moment of kind of mirroring what's going on and giving you this perspective. And so what, I'm happy to be here with all you strangers and kind of tell the story and these stories, because it's been kind of a realization that some of the stuff I've done is pretty amazing to me, and I can't do it without strangers, so thank you.
Thanks, guys.
I'm so sorry.
Do you have more?
One thing.
Okay, good.
I thought it was appropriate. I have a Maya Angelou quote. She has lots of great quotes. I took one. You may not control all the events that happen to you, but you can decide not to be reduced by them. So, thank you.
Seriously, thank you, Liz. So, before we open it up to have a conversation with you guys and get to answer some of your questions, I would like to add that if any of you feel like taking your first or 50th bike trip with Crystal and I, we're going to be leading an overnight camping trip sometime late February. So please come with us. We have bikes to rent out. We've got this bike, the Dolce Evo, you guys can borrow. And if you don't have a bike, we've got bikes for you. We can help you get set up so that you can take your first trip with us. My friend Heather is sitting right here. I'm gonna cry again. Yeah. When I got back from my trip, it took me a really long time to adjust back to LA. And to hear my friends have conversations that I didn't relate to anymore. And I went through a lot of depression and confusion trying to like immerse myself back into this world that I left. And Heather agreed to go on an overnight camping trip with me to Leo Carrillo in Malibu on Labor Day weekend. And she has this really old Trek, and she put her back panniers on there and went with me, and I think it was probably your longest bike ride you've ever done, but she was so game, and kind of that really was therapeutic to me to take like one more trip out there and meet this guy named Daryl who really would not tell us where he lived. He said he lived around San Diego. And then he started singing the Deliverance song to us. And then he was in the corner of the hike and bike campsite in like a fetal position, and he told us he doesn't like to sleep in a tent, he prefers to do it cocoon style. So all of these led up to, yeah, Daryl was homeless, but we hung out with him all night. He was really cool. So yeah, we would love to have you guys come with us. You can you can sign up tonight or on our Facebook page.
All we
had to eat was a bag of chips and a bottle of wine because there was no restaurants. And we thought we were depending on eating at Neptune's Net and it was closed. So that's what we had for dinner that night. But it was all right, right? It was fine. Also, that's another thing, when you're on the road, weird stuff happens to your body. I know I left my trip like looking like a climber, and during that time I gained 15 pounds and came back looking like Ronda Rousey, which turns out wasn't that bummed. I felt way more powerful than I've ever felt in my life, and like I could really like, you know, if needed. So anyway, does anybody have any questions for any of the ladies up here? Or?
Yeah. Well, my favorite like snack, gas station like food, I love peanut M&Ms. I love what else? That's my favorite. That's the thing I always have to get. Like, yeah. And then, yeah. I'm just gonna say that.
I survive off of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. And those like 20 gram Clif protein bars.
Our parts are a little more temperamental, I think. So, but honestly, you just have to take the plunge, and you'll eventually break that seal where you're just like comfortable being gross, and you're like kind of happy.
I will say though, it is okay to plan your trip around water, bodies of water. Like every lunch break I took on the divide was like there was a swimming opportunity, and that like made in my mind a difference. Or a campsite, we found campsites with a shower, and we purposely stayed there
just because we knew that'd be like our only.
Like you can, if you want to go that route, there's That's I think you can find that, you know, and lots of wipes.
I've also in the South, I was so there was like at one point in the South, it was the day that we crossed the Mississippi, and I had chiggers, which I didn't know what that was until I got them. They're like these little tiny like parasites that get under your skin. Oh. And yeah, it's different than scabies, but it's kind of similar. It's totally disgusting. They're itchy as hell. I had over 100 mosquito bites. I had poison ivy because I found some like crazy outlook in the middle of nowhere, and I made a handful of people like climb up 10,000 stairs with me to look, and we all got poison ivy. And all I wanted was a shower, and we were camping that night. And I literally, like, well, when we were in the South, we met a lot of people who were like, what are you doing? Where are you from? I've never left this town. This is amazing. And like, people were so generous, and they were buying us lunch. And that day, somebody literally offered to have us come to their house and take a shower, and I took them up on it because I was miserable. So between that and a ton of Benadryl, I slept, and it was okay.
When you were going totally self-sufficient, what was the most surprising, utterly indispensable thing that you had to take with you?
Have you guys ever heard of Desitin Creamy? Because that's the answer to a happy bum on the road.
That's what we use. Like
it's baby diaper rash ointment.
It works so much better than chamois cream when you're on your bike every day, all day.
That I couldn't have done it without that. Surprisingly, acne ointment, like with benzoyl peroxide in it, when you feel something coming, when it's like, I'm coming to ruin your life, you put that on first and it'll just, it won't ever be an issue. But like the Desitin Creamy, I was like an infant every night. If I got a shower, I would just put that on and then go to my tent and eat the chocolate.
The one thing with Desitin that you have to be careful of is it'll ruin the chamois of your shorts. It's oil-based, so it will cause your chamois to never absorb any moisture ever again.
You guys can, if you see my clothing rack over there, there's probably a lot of Desitin like residual on the chamois if you guys want to look at it after.
Sounds like you travel kind of heavy. Have any of you said you're hauling a trailer behind the bike, or how much stuff do you actually haul around?
We've done a family trip and we've hauled a trailer and it was miserable. So,
okay.
I don't know. It's just,
I think they pack pretty light,
yeah.
Right? I mean, that's a challenge, right, with any of that stuff, is how light can you pack? I think the first tour that we did, I weighed my Pan Airs and they were like 20 pounds. And now I look back on that, I'm like, God, that was so much stuff. I totally didn't need all that stuff. And that's not including water. Yeah, you just have to, like, anything you're not sure about, like, maybe don't bring it. Or if you're traveling with people, it's cool to, like, try to split up the stuff so you don't have duplicate stuff. Like, you only need, like, one stove between you, or you only need, like, stuff like that.
Or, like, if we shared a tent, I could carry poles and you could carry the, like, fabric. Also, you shed stuff. If you're on a long trip, you always start out with more than you need, and you just shed stuff. You either just dump it at a Goodwill or ship it at the next post office.
I gotta say, if it doesn't fit in my bags, I don't carry it. So I saw a lot of people, like, with tin cans going by, like, on the divide, like, things hanging out. You know? What?
Just Mary. Yeah, just a string of cans behind them.
I mean, because we're backpacking. If I couldn't fit in my backpack, it was not coming. Yeah. So,
yeah. Okay, I think we have time for one more question, if anybody has anything.
I carry a lot of emotional baggage.
I have a pleasure here, sorry.
Yes.
I was trying to get my wife to go on a camping trip, and the perfect thing is, one besides the dark, is critters. When you guys are by yourself, like, a couple of you, how do you feel, and being a woman, as a guy, I don't care, trying to convince my wife to do it, it's hard. How do you guys combat that mentally, like knowing something's out there that could eat you?
What can really eat us, though?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not scared of that. A bear?
She always says panthers.
Panthers? That's when you go,
Lord of Panthers?
Yeah.
Like, we're going to California.
I mean, there's lots of little things you could do. I mean, you can literally almost have, like, a little dance party at the end of the night, like, have a little speaker or something like that. You know, part of the divide, we carried, like, a little speaker for parts that were known for to have bears, and played Beyonce as loud as we could, Lemonade in particular. And, you know.
Bears hate that song.
They actually really love Beyonce, but they just kind of, no. But lights, you know, if you want to carry like a lantern, if it makes her feel better. If it's mental, if it's just coming over the mental part, you know, you could do a walk around and just make sure you feel like the area is clear, like with the flashlights, and just be like, this, we're good, you know.
It's not. You're not going to get eaten by, just don't take her somewhere where there's bears, you know?
It's taken a while, but I've had to convince myself that I'm more scared of what will happen if I don't do these things and missing out on these things than I am of the like, small chance that something might happen. The risk is worth the reward. You had a question? I think there's safety in numbers.
So you should always take someone with you.
If that's something that you're scared of, I think the best thing to do is to travel with
Yeah, I have that same fear. I don't do solo camping, even though you hear that it's safe, but I've never done it because I have the same fear. But when I'm with my friends, I don't feel that way. Like,
so you can go with a bunch of people and just be safe. But what if you just want to go on your own and just never do that?
No, I wouldn't say you never can, do that. But maybe start out small with friends and see how people react to you and gain like the confidence and the comfort to go out on your own. But don't just do that your first time.
I mean, you could. There's things to do. Like we talk to everybody. I talk to everybody. I make eye contact. I know like where I am. I usually, if I'm at a campsite, I walk around the whole campsite. I think being visual and understanding that, you know, people won't take advantage of people who kind of stand their own ground and make their own space, you know? And so I think that's you being present with everybody is a good way also.
Also, the times I've traveled by myself, I've carried mace.
Yeah, pepper spray, you
can. And just knowing that it's on me makes me feel more comfortable. Yeah. I don't know.
Hi to everybody, and so people know who you are as well.
Yeah, I think so. I think that's good advice.
Just one question. So, like, when you're biking, you get really warm. So, how do you guys manage a lot of variable temperature? Like, it can't be super cold at night. So, like, playing with gear and training, how do you know
how to do it? I love this jacket. It packs down super, super, super tiny. I use it as my pillow and to keep me warm at the campsite.
And then layers.
Yeah, layers, wool.
Yeah, wool.
Down
wool,
the, yeah, layers. That pack small.
Yeah. Lots of layers.
Yeah. I had people mail me stuff that I realized that I needed when I was on the road. So, like, I rode from New York down to almost Florida, and that was a whole different set of gear that I needed than when I was across the south in the desert. And I mailed boxes back and had people mail me stuff that I realized that was more appropriate.
I think Carrie's got a raffle that we're gonna do.
I have some goodies for you guys.
Is that right? Okay.
Thanks for all the awesome questions.
Yeah, thanks so much, you guys. Thanks for listening to our story.
Well, I just want to say thank you to you guys because this has been an amazing evening and you guys are incredibly inspiring. And I'm hoping that you guys got inspired by this to go out and just ride your bikes. Even if it's just get up tomorrow morning and just go for like a 20-minute spin. Just getting out there and doing the adventures and things that you've kind of always wanted to do. So thank you for your stories and for opening